they call it the.
Good morning, welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for February the 23rd. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Are there any additions or corrections for the February 17th Commissioner meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Hearing none, we'll move into the agenda. You're okay. We'll stop at your particular item, okay? Under authorizing budget department, adopt a resolution authorizing 2016 budget transfers in the amount of $1,221,520 and appropriations in the amount of $19,414, 2017 budget transfers in the amount of $103,062, and 2017 appropriations in the amount of $355,410 per listing dated February the 21st. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing Terrence Brennan, Administrator of the Berksheim, to execute a Pelican renewal quotation for the Berksheim nursing and rehab liability. Under Human Resources, we have several items. Item one, authorize the appointment of Molly Sanders to guardian ad litem in court administration. Item two, authorize the appointment of Christine Cahill to guardian ad litem, court administration. Item three, authorize the appointment of James Goldsmith to assistant district attorney four in the district attorney's office. And then four, authorize the promotion of Miguel Castro to lieutenant, from lieutenant to captain in the jail. Under purchasing, we have one item. Adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute as a result of an invitation to bid a contract for underground storage tank removal and closure. That goes to TTI Environmental Inc. out of Morristown, New Jersey. It's a not to exceed amount of $69,964. One item listed under myself, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Edward Annawalt, Burnville, PA, to the Berks County Park and Rec Board for a four-year term expiring March 10 of 2021. And then under commissioners, we have an item, item A, dealing with a project, and I'm going to recognize Paul Edelman. Did I do that again? I looked at him and I thought, said, Peter? He said, no, it's Paul.
Peter.
It could be Mary.
That would be worse, definitely.
That would be worse.
I'm not quite pretty enough to be a Mary. Thank you, Commissioner Leinbach.
You've got to be old enough to understand that.
The resolution that you're referring to on the agenda is one of the standard resolutions that you've grown accustomed to, approving a bond financing for Old Main LLC. Old Main is a newly formed organization related to the Lutheran Home at Topton. Old Main referring to the historical building on the Lutheran Home at Topton campus. This project is renovations and improvements to that old facility. It's a tax-exempt financing benefit from the lower interest rates available in the tax-exempt markets. As you're aware, before tax-exempt bonds can be issued on behalf of private entities, a public hearing is required to be held, and the Board of Commissioners are then asked to approve the project as required by the provisions of the Internal Revenue Code. As we've noted in the past, there's no obligation of the county with respect to this project. This is merely an approval required as a condition to issuing tax-free debt. The approximate amount of the loan is $6.1 million. It's a significant improvement to the facility to modernize it and make it a long-term asset to the Lutheran home at Topton. The bonds are going to be issued by the Maxatony Township Municipal Authority. They conducted the public hearing. So I guess at this point, I just ask to see if you have any questions or comments regarding the project.
I have no comments regarding the specific project, but I think this is a great opportunity to make an important point. There is significant discussion once again in Washington regarding tax reform, and one of the areas that is being seriously considered is either the limiting or the outright elimination of tax-free municipal bonds. Counties, states in particular, and municipalities rely very, very heavily on tax-free municipal bonds, somewhat less so in the nonprofit sector. But this is a huge debate. As recently as this week, I was asked to contact all four of our congressmen because the House is considering a broad package of tax reform, and I'm not being critical of the broad objectives of that reform. I'm actually very supportive, but somehow there's a misunderstanding that these tax-free municipal bonds are used to build stadiums. That's that what you continue to hear. And the last that we looked at the national level, stadium use is like less than 1% of the overall use. Overwhelmingly, this is for public projects, public infrastructure, or projects like this that are clearly for the public good. Just perspective-wise for our viewers, what is the rate of this particular debt instrument versus what it would have been if it, the impact would have been if it wasn't tax-free?
Sure, that's a good question. The savings, you know, the well, to be more specific, the difference between the rate is approximately 2%. And over a 25-year loan, that would be a significant amount of additional interest costs to the organization.
So it's a big issue.
It's a big savings.
I know Bob Petrizio is sitting back there. We have at least one, maybe more, tax-free municipal bonds. They're very strictly monitored. Bob has to verify that we're not generating any revenue as a result of projects where those bonds were used. Correct, Bob?
In generally speaking, yeah.
Yeah, by revenue, for-profit revenue. Like cell towers, if we hung AT&T on a tower, we'd have an issue relative to tax-free municipal bond.
Except that we use taxable bonds for those. So
okay, if we had.
But generally speaking, you have to. If there's private use rules, you have to comply with.
Right.
And I think that's what you're alluding to. And we do have several bond issues that are tax exempt, mm-hmm. not just one.
Yep.
And it saves millions of dollars.
For taxpayers.
Right.
Well, the bottom line is if the legislation you're talking about was included, if in that bill they included the elimination, mm-hmm. our property taxes would have to go up eventually.
Right.
Assuming they grandfather what you've already done.
Yeah, it would grandfather what's in place. It would be for anything going forward. And that, unfortunately, could cause some serious, serious issues. But just want to make you aware, I've heard back from one, Congressman Costello, and he is signing on to the letter supporting the county position. I've heard back from Congressman Dent, he's looking into it, and I've heard back from me, and he's looking into it. I don't think I've gotten a response yet from Congressman Smucker, but it's an important issue.
I would agree.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope you don't mind me using the opportunity to explain how important the bigger issue is.
No, I appreciate that, and thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm just impressed you know the four names of the congressmen who represent Berks.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go.
Right.
Okay, with that, we'll go to item B, adopt a resolution ratifying, confirming, and approving the chief clerk to advertise enactment of proposed Berks County ordinance, approving the participation in and the execution of an intergovernmental transfer agreement between the Pennsylvania Department of Human Services, Office of Long-Term Living, and Berks County for intergovernmental transfer of funds in order to provide the non-federal share of medical assistance payment to the county nursing facility. There had to be an easier way to say that. But that's government ease, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Item two, a motion authorizing the chair of the board to execute contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator per attached listing dated February the 21st, 2017. There are eight contracts. There's one with Agland Preservation, one with Budget, three with Children and Youth Services, one with Facilities and Operations, and two with the Berks County Jail. And then a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth in the Comptroller's Office voucher. The listing is dated February the 21st of 17 for the week ending February 22nd. And the payment of electronic transfers and payroll that's been signed and is with our chief clerk.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
I'll second that motion.
Bob wants to third
discussion. We have item back here with Bob Petruzio.
Commissioners, without saying a whole lot, would it be possible to add another name to 64.17? This has to be sent back by March 1st.
64.17. What is the other name?
Could we add Diane Guarino in case our current administrator is unable to sign the form?
Motion to amend.
We'll accept that.
Thank you.
Is that proper parliamentary procedure?
A friendly amendment.
Yeah. That was a friendly amendment.
We're just accepting it as an amendment.
As an alternative.
Right.
Either or type of thing.
He made the motion. He's accepted it. I seconded it. I'm accepting it. So we'll have that.
Thank you.
You've got the correct information then?
I'll get the name.
Okay.
That's government in action there when you see something like that happen.
Get it done.
We didn't have to turn this over to a committee.
Or get her done.
Yeah.
Okay. With that, any other discussion?
Just a comment on the human resource item for Miguel Castro being promoted from lieutenant to captain. He did a phenomenal job of getting us compliant with the Prison Rape Elimination Act. Probably took us well over a year and a half to 2 years till we were inspected and approved. This is really a well-deserved promotion from lieutenant to captain for Miguel Castro. So I don't often call people out that do a lot of dedicated work for the county. He's a superstar out there at the jail. So really glad to see him stepping up and taking on more responsibility. Thank you.
Very good. With that, we'll turn to Dennis Adams, our county treasurer, for the treasurer's report.
We'll just get her done, huh?
Yeah.
Get her done.
I like that. We need to do that. The opening balance today is $126,372,169.53. A balance to clear of $5,356,816.10, leaving us with a balance of $121,015,353.43.
Thank you very much, Dennis. And we'll turn to our county controller, Sandy Graffius.
Total accounts payable $2,598,254. We have wire transfers $3,315,807. We had a payroll this week $4,136,159 for a grand total of disbursements of $10,050,221.54.
Very good. Thank you. We'll turn to our Chief Financial Officer, Bob Petruzio, for the agenda for this afternoon's budget operations meeting.
Thank you, Commissioners. We are going to present the cash flow forecast for 17, 18, and 19 updated.
Three cheers for cash flow.
And just a recap of how we ended 2016, because that establishes the opening balance for 17. And
I came here 10 minutes early.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, 69, you want to have a camera here. I mean, this stuff is
it's riveting. Riveting.
We will try to make it entertaining.
It'll be big.
Yeah.
I mean, really big.
Here's the word of the day. It's all about timing.
We're going to make the budget process great again.
There are some permanent differences. But the second item, we're going to discuss some office space needs and the ability to create some space for a position that's being hired. And then we're going to add a third item will be Justin Luce will be here to ask to accelerate a IS project that was spread between 17 and 18 into 17.
Just for truth in advertising, for our listeners that are making plans to be here this afternoon, it's actually pretty dry, pretty dull, pretty boring. So,
but it's important.
I'll admit that. But it's important.
But it's important.
We don't deny that cash flow is important.
The money's important, right, Tex?
Yeah.
We have two elevators set aside just for the crowd that's going to be coming up. So.
I'm glad they work.
Right.
Hey, we're doing well. Thank you.
Very good. On that note, Ron Seaman, our Chief Administrative Officer.
Thank you, Christian. I have nothing to offer. This is something other than it's
very good.
That's a country song.
I think any day is a great day to be alive.
That's a country song.
It sure beats the alternative.
Yeah.
Commissioner Barnhardt.
Sure. Yes, just a one follow-up item, one Saturday morning item. About 2 weeks ago, we had a discussion about letting a contract for a feasibility study for the Rack Pedestrian Bridge. This circles back to a meeting we had on August 4th of last year discussing the Rack Bridge, which is aptly named because it was transferred from Rack to the county in 2008 or 2009. It's primarily a pedestrian bicycle path connecting the Toon Trail into the city and back out to Western Berks County. And I guess there's been a little concern on social media buzzing around about the future of that bridge. We have made some comments, no formal decisions, but as a county asset, I will clarify my comments that it really is of no significant value to the county in its present state. But I, for one, and I believe the comments back in August, as far as Commissioner Leinbach, we are not going to cut off access for pedestrians and bikers in the future until we certainly have a firm understanding of what kind of alternative way folks could get from the Toon Trail over across the river to Reading.
Are you trying to drag me into your
problems? No, I'm referencing back to your comments from August. Yeah, you're on here.
My wife told me, don't discuss the Rack Ridge.
I did
my homework. Let Kevin Barnhart go down with the ship.
I did my homework. You're quoted here on August 4th. So if you want to
I will comment.
Listen, this is going to be somewhere out in the future, probably far out in the future. It kind of ties in to whatever plans PennDOT has for the Bingham Street Bridge. We are advocating for, and we think at least we have their understanding of not just a painted line safety provision on the Bingham Street Bridge, but a connector, almost like a separate pedestrian biker unit that can be mounted to the bridge. If that would occur, if PennDOT would agree to that, this could be 10 years down the road, then we would really see no value to continue to have the Rack Bridge in its present form. Many municipalities, many states ignore infrastructure till it's to the point where you can't use it. People certainly can use this, but it is in quite a state of disrepair. Last time it was inspected was about 8 years ago. We had actually frogmen down there shoring up the piers. So this is actually a periodic inspection of one of the county assets. But long term it may not be here, but again it will be here as long as we if we don't have some solution to get bikers and pedestrians back and forth with the advent of an improvement on the Bingham Street Bridge. So did I clarify my comments? So people out there in the social media center, there's a lot of buzz out there. I had one call yesterday from a friend of mine, and I explained it to him. He said, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know you guys talked about that back in August. So I clarified it with him. Last but not least, I'm inviting the public to our Mount Penn Preserve meeting Saturday. We want to hear from the community at large about your thoughts about Mount Penn, what you like about it, what you think should be enhanced, any sorts of improvements you would like to see long term. We're meeting at City Council in Chambers Saturday morning from 10 to 1, and then a second session from 1 to 4. Parking is free at the Doubletree by Hilton on Saturday, so please come out. If you're passionate about Mount Penn and the other amenities there, whether it's the Stokes A or Captain's Cove or Liederkranz or City Park, Carsonia Park, this is all included in this Mount Penn Preserve Master Plan. We really want to do a short-term, long-term expectations of this asset that we think is a real gem here in Berks County. We want to preserve it, we want to enhance it, but we want to do it right. We want to make sure we hear from everyone who uses it now and who would like to use it if there were other additional improvements or amenities added to the Mount Penn Preserve area. So look forward to seeing you all on Saturday. There you go.
I had to smile. I'm away in Haiti, and the two guys that were left here blow up social media, and as I understand, feedback.
And it wasn't you.
With the Rack Bridge. Right. And actually, there were some people saying, please note, Commissioner Leinbach wasn't part of this. So, I think a key piece of information was missing, and I talked to some people that called and were rather upset. Said, look, I do not support removing the Rack Bridge until the alternative is built by PennDOT at the Binghamton Street area. That's number one. Number two, to keep the Rack Bridge in the new realignment of the West Shore Bypass actually creates a more dangerous situation on the western side, on the West Reading side, because it ends up going down into a tunnel. In order for everything to get by. And that's just a bad, bad setup. You're asking for trouble. So in time, when the access is completed, what are you looking at?
Well, page one of August 5th was the Toon Trail Bridge has uncertain future, and page two was Seaman as new top county administrator. And I'm surprised he's lasted this long.
Okay.
August 4th, right? Wow.
Very good.
You look a little older, though, from back in August.
Yeah, that was an old photograph.
He actually looks older here than he does now. I think he's gotten younger. But anyhow, the Rack Bridge, I don't support eliminating the Rack Bridge until the alternative Binghamton Street access is complete and in place. It's really simple as that. Hopefully that additional information will encourage a lot of the people that had, I think, legitimate concerns. The two concerns I heard, why are you spending $40,000 on another study? And two was, how do we get back and forth east and west and access to the trail? And the answer to that's very simple. We're not going to get rid of it until that access is in place. Coming up, two events over at the Ag Center that I want to highlight. Friday, March the 17th, we will be having another Ag Career Day Fair at the Ag Center. This is hosted by BARN, which is the Berks Agricultural Resource Network. It's free, it's open to students, public school, private school, homeschool, a large number of exhibitors, businesses, in some cases nonprofits, Penn State Extension, Pennsylvania Veterinary and Medical Association, PA Department of Ag, FM Brown, Effort and National Bank, Anilani Orchards, et cetera, et cetera. Jurgelwitz and Sons. A lot of different ag businesses or ag organizations will be there to interview students. Talk to them about careers in agriculture. Great event. Encourage if you know anyone, any students, high school in particular, that are looking at a career in agriculture, this is an event to attend. And then the following week, Tuesday, March 21st, is National Ag Day. And as we've done in prior years, our Berks County Department of Ag, headed by Tammy Hildebrand, will be hosting a special event at the Ag Center. The theme this year are markets growing and selling. They're going to be talking about local farm operations that are growing and raising local products and selling them largely through either CSAs or farm markets. There'll be a panel at 8:30 in the morning of growers and how they grow the product and how they deal with the selling. And then at 10 a.m., there is a farmer market centric panel talking about a variety of the farmers markets, everything from a Leesport or fairgrounds to farm stands you see up in the Fleetwood area and throughout the county. So it should be a very informative program. At 11:30, there will be an open house of all of our ag partners. They will be providing food and refreshment, again, free for everyone that comes out to that event. Registration starts at 8 a.m. The program begins at 8:30, and probably we will end at 2 p.m., the open house lunch portion. So hopefully you can get out to that event. With that, is there any comment from our row officers? Yes, Fred.
Two things to mention. First was I had the answer to a burning question that's been plaguing the community for the last couple of days. My second deputy, Nicholas Embezzi, was appointed to borough council in West Reading the other night, and they asked him, he's 25, was he the youngest council member ever? Commissioner Barnhardt cleared that up for me. He said, no, that was himself, and he was 23.
Right.
I'm just dumbfounded that 50-some years ago, they
we were desperate.
Desperate.
Another item is with the tax-exempt bonds. Mm-hmm. I just think this is another example of campaign finance running amok. Because other than the issue with maybe some stadiums are built with these mm-hmm. things, these are really needed good projects. You know, I remember when I was first working in banking, not quite as long ago as that, but back in the 80s, the people come in with their little bond coupons. Mm-hmm. You know, they cash them in, we put them in these little clear bags and send them off to the bank, you know, for them. And they knew what they were investing in, like their local water authority or their local sewer mm-hmm. authority, things like that. You know, so they had like an interest in those bonds themselves. But I can just see that if this is kind of a close vote in Congress, we're going to be bombarded with those infomercial commercials, you know, with the pay by, you know, some shadow agency. And they're going to blow up this, make it sound like all of this money is going for these extravagant things that we don't need, and, you know. But it really comes down to the great big banks and financial houses are trying to get this passed so they get those high loan rates and the little guy doesn't get their nice little bond. And that's what it comes down to. And that's all based on campaign finance.
That's a big part of it. The other part of it is the same thing we see in Harrisburg, and I think you would agree. So few of our legislators at the state and federal level really understand the budgetary connections between county government, state government, county government, and federal government. It is amazing when you sit down with legislators and explain children and youth funding. They're stunned. That most of them do not even know how much we do at the local level relative to federal programming and state programming. Stunning, but that's the truth. Yeah. So,
and it's a shame that they don't listen to us as much as they may listen to somebody who's giving them $100,000 campaign.
Right. Well, I'm headed to DC actually tomorrow morning for the NACO Legislative Conference. Tax-free municipal bonds are one of the major items on our agenda, and the amazing thing is we've worked out the numbers for counties and for states on what they've saved over the last 10 to 20 years on, by using tax-free municipal bonds. And when you look at the cumulative over 20 years, it's in the trillions. Actually, trillions that we've spent using tax-free municipal bonds. And the idea is, if you look at one side of the equation, you understand the federal government's looking for savings. So they see all this tax-free money being lost. So they say, for argument's sake, here's $500 billion that we can bring in. But what they have to ask the question is, okay, who's going to pay that tax at the local level? And overwhelmingly, that goes back to state and local taxpayers, because we are the vast user of the tax-free municipal bond. And that's where the disconnect occurs. Hopefully, we'll be on the Hill Tuesday and Wednesday, meeting with legislative leaders. Meeting Wednesday, there's a meeting with the White House. Vice President Mike Pence is leading that. This is the kind of stuff we fight for, and this is why you need association involvement. This is why Kevin Barnhardt is on the board of directors of CCAP, and I'm on the board of directors of our state association. If we had to fight this battle by ourselves, we'd have four congressmen and two senators to talk to. But when we come together collectively, and I will tell you, there are no R's and D's when we talk about tax-free municipal bonds. There's absolutely no debate among county leaders anywhere in the country. And there's 3,069 counties, and we all agree tax-free municipal bonds are important, and they protect our local taxpayers in building of critical local infrastructure. And we are taking that message to Washington starting this Friday through next Wednesday. So thanks for reiterating that again. Any other comments? Dennis?
I just wanted to give you an update. On January 17th, the unpaid taxes were turned over to the county to collect. And this year we had 9,736. It's down a little bit. It was 9,888 last year. I don't know if that's a trend.
Taxpayers.
These are tax bills that are unpaid.
Unpaid. What do you know the total value?
I
think it's 19.
Tax. Yeah, it's $19,436,000.
Right.
Yep. And I wanted to let everybody know Tuesday the 2017 tax bills will be mailed out effective the 1st.
Thanks a lot.
Just don't shoot the reporter, buddy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Any comments from the public?
Motion to adjourn.
Meeting is adjourned.